All right, welcome to today's lecture. Today we're going to be talking about a couple of relatively short chapters focusing on formatting and then a little bit about, just a very little bit about data abstraction. Additionally, I have Lab 3 open, and the idea behind Lab 3 is that you're going to be essentially doing a code review looking at one file, which is this wagecalculation.cs. I had to upload that as a zip file in the Dropbox, so you'll have to download and extract that. So I'll be looking at this as a code review and then looking at the code and trying to apply some of these early concepts that we're talking, that we've been talking about over the last couple of lectures. This file is relatively large. There's about 1,400 or 1,500 lines or so inside the program itself, well, almost 1,600. And so the idea here is not to exhaustively study and analyze this file. There's just way too much to do that. The idea behind it is just to look for general trends. And so if you, for the first question, you know, for example, the first question here, we're talking about naming. And so if you look at the overall structure, you should be able to, just in the first few lines, the first few functions, you should be able to get a sense or an idea of how this author is using that or applying the naming conventions here. So you should then be able to, based off of that, you know, provide a good answer. Again, you don't have to go through every single function in here because there are a lot of functions. Additionally, you don't necessarily need to get in here and understand exactly what these functions are doing. Question two talks about functions. So we had an entire lecture where we talked about or delved into functions and general practices for those or guidelines that were outlined. And so, you know, pick a function or pick two functions and just describe, you know, is this one too long? Does it only do one thing? If it doesn't do one thing, then what would you recommend? How would you split it up? And what would that second function, what would the name of that function become? And so, you know, you don't need to look at all of the, I don't know how many functions are in this file, 20 or 30 or so, but just pick one or two that would help you to discuss that concept. And relay that information to someone that you were providing that this code review to. This file comes from, there's a project that some students, some on-campus students, undergraduate students are working on, and it's really one of the first big software development projects that they've worked on. And so, you know, they approached this and wrote this code from a perspective, from a point where it's relatively new to them. And so I think this gives us a good opportunity then to look at that style and then apply, you know, from more of a leadership, mentorship, senior developer, whatever you want to call it, type of role to help, you know, make it a little bit better. Let's see. Okay, so I think with all these questions then, you know, really the point of the question I tried to state in the first sentence, these additional sentences there are just to help. You know, when we're talking about functions, there's a lot of different topics that we can talk about. And so you don't have to limit yourself to just answering these questions. You can discuss, you know, pretty much anything you want that falls just kind of within this range. So hopefully that makes sense. Hopefully what I was able to convey that to you here. If something in here, if I've confused you, if I'm not clear on anything, please, you know, don't hesitate to send me an email or reach out and let me know. Odds are that if I've confused you, I've probably confused everybody else. So, you know, please don't let that slow you down. Let me know when I can provide any clarity there. The application itself, just to give you an idea what that looks like. What is going on here? Okay, this is the actual application. And so this project that these students are working on is for the Governor's Office of Economic Development. And what the application, what that code is that you're going to look at, it's actually a lot of the calculations that are being performed. What this application does is you provide it with an input value, a gross wage, and pick your locality here, and then go ahead and click calculate. And what it will do, oh, did that change? I think so. What it will do then is it'll tell you what is your after-tax wages and what is your purchasing power. And so it makes some adjustments and calculations based off of really your cost of living and everything. So you make $45,000. In Montana and Missoula, you actually would take home about 35. And now if we take that number and let's compare it and see if I can real quickly find, okay, Phoenix is probably going to be an expensive place to live, relatively speaking, and we put in 45,000 there. Now we click calculate. Okay, so it came up with about the same number. So that what that is telling us that $45,000 in Missoula and $45,000 in Arizona is about the same. Now, I'm making some assumptions here that our calculations are correct. We're still going through the process with this application. We're still going through some quality assurance and some beta testing and verifying with the people that are the tax experts at the state that these calculations are correct. But the state then will take this project, and the intent is to make it, you know, this is a mobile-friendly application. And what they'll probably do is, or what they'll end up using this for, is for recruitment purposes, you know, to show that there are, you know, the money you make in D.C., while your salary number might look good, the cost of living is really high. And so that same salary or a smaller salary in a Sioux Falls area or Rapid City or Pierre or something, a smaller number, you might actually have more take-home pay because of all of these different adjustments and taxes that come out. So even though it's an active project for us right now, you know, what you provide and you respond, we're not going to use it to change any of their code. So it's just between you and me as far as your submission goes. So if you're interested, though, in getting involved on the project, if you'd like to provide some of that leadership mentorship type thing, do some code reviews for real for those guys, I'm sure I'd be more than happy to set that up and facilitate that. Just let me know. All right. So to get in the material for today, I'm going to keep the presentation here relatively short. I'm not going to go full screen because the last time I went full screen here, it actually caused my system to crash. And so I'm still, I've recently upgraded to Yosemite on my Mac, and I'm still working out some bugs on it. So I'm going to go ahead and stay small screen here so I don't have to go through another reboot. Today, we'll talk about a little bit about formatting, because formatting has a tremendous impact on your code and the overall maintainability and readability of it. It gives a first impression as well. And, you know, I've spent a lot of time now at this point writing code, looking at code, maintaining other people's code, looking at open source projects, obviously writing my own code, and now grading a lot of code, in which case, you know, on the grading side and on all sides of it, all aspects of it, you know, when you first open up that file and you first take a look at somebody's code, it is a first impression. You know, when I open up a student's submission and it's just a hodgepodge mess of non-formatted stuff, then the first impression is, well, they don't really care. They don't really care about the code, or the quality just isn't going to be very good. If they don't care enough to make their format their code correctly, they're probably not going to have good quality code in the first place. And now that's a little bit harder in dealing with students, especially, you know, the lower level courses, because, you know, they're still relatively new to it. But the same with colleagues. When I open up code from a colleague and it's just really hard to read, my impression, even if the code is great, my impression is always usually, ooh, this isn't going to be good code, because I have to take time in order, typically what I do is I haven't taken time to clean it up a little bit to make it a little bit easier to read so that it's easier for me to understand what's going on. Our job, our whole, you know, our job as programmers is communication and trying to communicate. And when we write code, our code is trying to accomplish a task and communicate to others that have to read it how we are going about doing that. And it isn't always about just getting it to work, because the code's going to change. Code that I've written, and I'm sure written, you know, at jobs past, you know, I'd be surprised if a lot of it was still in use, just because simply because programs change, processes change. And so, you know, how I wrote that is probably morphed a lot since the time that I was there, you know, writing code for these companies. The format, though, is something that we want to stick with. And I find it very easy as a developer that if I open up a project, I'm writing code and it's already well-structured and well-maintained and well-formatted, you know, it's very easy to get into that habit and write code that fits right in with that style and that format. If it's not, if it's just a hodgepodge mess, then it's a little bit harder, or I'm less likely to do it because, you know, why have my one little section that looks good and formatted when the rest of the file with all the other lines are not well-formatted or well-maintained? And I may or may not have time to go and clean it up, you know, so that's another challenge that comes with not keeping the code clean. As far as formatting, I think it really, you know, we'll talk about some general rules or guidelines or styles or techniques to create or to, you know, when you look at how you're going to format, you know, but the bottom line really is, How can you, apply a set of simple rules, choose a set of simple rules, define those rules, apply them, be consistent. The team needs to agree. They may not agree on every single rule or how you're applying it or implementing it, but they should still be able to agree that this is our set of standards that we'll use. Keep them relatively simple. I think that, it almost sounds silly to talk about formatting, but it is so very important. And everything that we'll talk about is relatively straightforward and relatively simple. Okay, so when we look at formatting, there's kind of three general things that we care about. The vertical, the horizontal, and then the formatting itself. Okay, so when we start talking about vertical limits, we got to first ask ourselves, well, how big is too big? And kind of with everything that we're going to talk about today, it depends. It depends. It's kind of subjective in a way. Smaller files are usually much easier to read. If we go back to the sample code for the lab, okay, and I said, tell me what this file does. Well, this thing is, 1,600 lines of code. This is going to take a while for you to tell me and figure out exactly what it does. If this file only went to here, it was only a couple hundred lines long, it'd be much easier. You could open this up and say, well, it looks like it does something with Social Security and the federal standard deduction. In this case, it's a bunch. There's a lot more functionality here because it's a lot larger of a file. Could we break this up then? And we probably definitely could. We could probably identify functionality that's closely related and then break it up into smaller files, break it up into different static classes in order to organize that, to make this overall structure smaller so that it's a little bit easier to read. Again, that's generally speaking. There may be very good cases where having a file, a source file that's 2,000 lines long makes perfect sense. The author discusses a newspaper metaphor. And if we think about how we're writing our code, kind of like how a newspaper is structured, we want the title, the name of the file, to be kind of like a title. And that is that the file name itself, again, we're back to naming, and it's very important that the file name itself should tell us what this code is all about, what is going to happen, what's going to occur inside this file, what is the purpose or the functionality of it. And based off of that file name, opening that file up, we really shouldn't be too surprised to see, we shouldn't really be surprised what we find inside of it. If we are, then we need to look at the name and the functionality, and is everything matching up? With the newspaper itself and the actual way we structure our code, we want it to kind of read in ever-increasing detail. And I'm not saying that that's how newspaper articles read. I guess maybe I'm deviating from the metaphor a little bit here. But in implementation, that is what we want. We want it to start off with functions, and then if that function calls any other functions, those are defined below it. And then if those functions call any other functions, it's defined below it. And generally speaking, we're going from a higher level of abstraction in the code to the lowest level that module or those functions are going to handle. And so we're going to go from abstraction, from function calls that kind of hide the implementation, to functions that are very down in the weeds. This is where the actual calculations occur. What makes newspapers usable? Well, that it's generally, they're generally composed of several small articles with a few large ones. And so again, I guess to come back to the newspaper metaphor, we can kind of take that idea as we're structuring our code, and several smaller files with a few large ones, but it, overall keeping things broken down and contained in a way that makes sense, organized in a way that everything is relational, will help overall with the maintainability and the usability and the readability of our overall code. Here's an example of some code that I use in one of my 250 classes. And you can see here the sample on the left. I eliminated all vertical spacing. Okay. And so when you look at this file, and you look particularly from this main, where main is declared, to the top, what you see is that it's very hard, just glancing at that, it's very hard to pull out the individual pieces and understand overall what is the structure here. On the right, we go back to having some vertical separation. And then we can see, okay, it's very easy to quickly go. These is the includes are here. We have a structure definition here. Here's a type definition. And here is our function prototypes. And so we can quickly identify what each section is, and then we can skip over it if we don't need it. If I'm not interested in these function prototypes, then I can skip it because I can see that they're all you know, grouped together because of their similar behavior, their relationship. And so, you know, spacing, this vertical spacing allows us to help. The more closely related, the less vertical spacing. Okay, so with these function prototypes, between each prototype, I don't have an additional space. I keep them all together. There's no spaces because they're closely related. Between the type definitions and the prototypes, I provide a space because they're not as closely related. They are still, of course, a part of the structure, and adding in a second or a third space doesn't really add anything to the readability, but they're independent. They're slightly different because these type definitions are not the same, of course, as the function prototypes. Okay, some other considerations then that we have when we're dealing in the vertical space here, the vertical properties of our code, and we just kind of talked about that, is the density. So the closer the lines of code, the closer the relationship, the more spread out they are. Again, everything should be related because everything inside this class is related to the code at hand. It's related to, in this case, talking about linked lists. But the closer together, the tighter the relationship. Distance. Talks about relatively the same thing. Variable declaration, and that we want variables to be declared as close to their usage as possible. And this becomes relatively easy if we follow the principle of functions being short and only doing one thing. And so that way, if we declare our variables in our functions, our local variables should be able to be declared at the top because the functions aren't very long. So declaring them at the top is consistent, and they're declared close to where they're used. If they're not, and your functions span very long, or they're very large, you know, it gets harder. If you have a 300-line function, and you declare all your variables at the top, or maybe you don't. You don't declare them at the top. You declare them close to where they're used. You know, it gets a little bit harder to see where those variables are. What kind of variables are used? What kind of functionality does that function actually have or perform? And so, you know, keeping the function short does help with this readability, especially when we're looking at how we structure or organize our code in that vertical space. Dependent functions, it's good to group them. You know, there's kind of two ways that I've seen code and developers go about. One is just a hodgepodge. You have a bunch of functions and you write them and you declare them and you don't really care. And I've done that myself. But you keep them grouped together by their usage or by what they actually do. And so functions that are typically closely related by what they're performing, it's easier for those to be grouped together because those are oftentimes going to be used in conjunction with each other. So the basic idea here is that functions that call other functions should be close together. That way that when you look at a function and you're looking at its implementation and you see that it calls another function, you don't have to go very far to find the definition or the implementation of that function. You know, it's maybe the next function down or two or three down. It's relatively close. This gets a little bit more challenging because we have, if you use a robust editor or an IDE like Visual Studio or Eclipse, it's very easy to go to a function and then just say, you know, right click, go to this definition or go to the implementation. And so with that capability, it's very easy to not worry about the proximity of where you're defining it or implementing it because your IDE can allow you to jump around very rapidly and very quickly. You're not just using a plain old text editor to find those things. But again, the overall maintainability, it is easier. It still is easier to see a function that calls another function and then be able to see that that's defined right below that one. It still saves you the trouble of having to, you know, use the navigator to jump to that place in code or jump to another file, use the navigator to jump back. You know, you can still get lost in all the jumping around that you do. This is out of our book. This is a pretty good example, I think, of this concept of keeping you know, function definitions and the implementation of them relatively close. You know, if we trace through this code again, we don't necessarily have to understand exactly what this code is doing. In fact, we don't really have to understand anything of the implementation at all right now. What we're just looking at is the functions. So if we see public response, make response, and we look inside of here, one of the first functions that is called is get page name or default. If we look at the preceding function definitions, then we can see the first function defined after that one is get page name or default. If we look at load page, we go back into this function, we can see that sure enough, it's the next one defined. And then not found response and make page response, we can see here, not found response and make page response. And so, you know, not only are they close in relation to where they're called, but they're also called in the same order. They're defined in the same order. And so, again, we're just trying to add, you know, increase the maintainability, the readability of this code based off of how we structure this. Because there's nothing stopping us from putting all of these functions before make response or putting them in really any order that we want. Horizontal formatting, this one is, in general, it's kind of like vertical, and that is that you want to keep things relatively short. You know, kind of the key to everything here that we've talked about is we've gotten and talked about code structure and code formatting is that we want to keep things relatively short, because the shorter it is, relatively speaking, the easier it is to understand or process. If you have to scroll, so there's kind of been this general rule that if you have to scroll to the left or the right, you've gone too far. Well, that's a little bit harder to apply that rule because we have, you know, of course we have monitors that are large monitors with high resolution, so we can get, you know, a lot of characters in the horizontal space that we have available to us. And so you can look in the book, the author, they did some code analysis on some very popular projects, and they've come up with the average size. And the average number of characters, the average width is, I don't remember, 40 or 50 or so lines long, or characters long. Again, the general idea is, though, that if you can keep everything on a single line, you can and keep it, for the most part, within the ability of the developer to read without having to scroll, then it helps. It makes it easier to look at that code and process and understand what it's doing. Horizontal alignment has been one of these weird issues for me that I've had. It's come up ever since I started programming, and I've run into a lot of people, a lot of different developers that have very, you know, opinionated, a very strong opinion on how to do this. You know, originally, I've seen this style from, I don't even remember how long ago. And originally, I guess I'm a lot like the author, in that originally I thought this added a lot of clarity to it, and that lining everything up, it made it very clean, it made it very easy to read. And you can see here, variable declaration. Here is the, you know, the scope of it. This is the type of it. This is the name, and then we terminate the statement. Inside the function itself, kind of the same thing. Here we've got variable assignment. We've got the assignment operator, and then we align up the values. And the idea being, well, you can quickly scan through here and read. Well, the problem with this is that it really doesn't add any readability, and it oftentimes will force you or cause you to focus on the wrong thing. That is that when I read this, my eye just tends to scale down this column and then scale down this column instead of reading it left to right like I should. And so it's very subtle, it's very small change, but it can have a big impact on the code. And so both the author and I now, I no longer use this style, although I used to years ago. So again, it's very small things, but these small things can have a big impact on how much effort is it for someone to come and read and maintain your code. Okay, indentation. Indentation is absolutely critical. There's just no way around it. While I don't typically see code this bad, if you look at some code, and these two screenshots again right out of the book, they're the exact same thing. This one removes pretty much all formatting, and then this one is well formatted. And I mean, there's no replacement for indenting and formatting your code properly, because this is very hard, very painful to read. It would take a long time. In fact, if this was code I was actually reviewing, I'd probably take the time and properly format it, or find some tool that would properly format it for me. With this one, again, very easy to read. You can quickly pull out the different functions and names and properties and what they're doing, and that there's a try-catch. It's all very easy to read. So, you know, formatting is just absolutely critical when it comes to this in our code. Okay, so with all that, you know, again, there's just, you know, small techniques that we can use, that we can implement in order to make our code better. Working in a team environment, it really, again, it really comes down to coming together as a team, identifying the styles that you want to use, and then adopting it. Be consistent with those styles and use them across the team. When somebody deviates from it, you know, catch it in a code review and make them redo it. Make them adhere to the standards that the team has come. If everybody starts deviating from the standards, then re-attack on those standards, and maybe it's time to change those so that you are using a style that everybody wants to and everybody agrees to. Coming up with the rules, your main purpose is to communicate clearly through your code. And so, you know, not everybody may have their own personal style represented in the standards that you adopt, but that's not the most important part. The most important part is that your code is clean, it's maintainable, and that everybody is following those standards. Okay, I've just got a few slides here, then talk about data abstraction. One of the things with data abstraction, what we're trying to do is that we're talking about hiding implementation in our code. And oftentimes that is a very desirable way of how we structure our code. One of the things that the author bemoans is that, you know, right away in a class, you declare some members and then you define getters and setters. And when you define those getters and setters, then you reveal some of the implementation, or you remove some of the implementation, the abstraction in that implementation from that class. Here's an example in the book, and we have this class point with two variables, x and y, and then we have this abstract class point. It's an interface. And we have some get x, get y. We have a couple of set routines, set Cartesian, set polar, get r, and then get theta. And what this, you know, what this boils down to is we're controlling. There is some control in the way that this is implemented, and that you can get the individual values for x and y. You know, if we're dealing with a point in space, you know, we care about the x and the y, perhaps, maybe even the z, but in this case, just x and the y. You can expose the value individually, but you're not exposing the implementation of how you're setting that. And so if you in order to set both x and y using this interface, you have to do it at the same time. You can't set x individually, you can't set y individually. You have to do it calling one of these functions, in which case then how they're set, you know, set Cartesian or set polar, the implementation of that is as abstracted away. We don't care. All we know is that when we want to set a point, we have to call one or the other and then provide the appropriate values. With this class here, that's not the case. All we simply have is x and y. And how we implement that is done outside of this structure now. Okay, we have a very similar example with this listing. So listing 3.6.3 and listing 6.4. We have this vehicle class. And we have two functions, get fuel tank capacity in gallons, get gallons of gasoline. And so the implementation of this is left to the caller of the class, and that we can't get the fuel state without calling both of these functions, returning that numeric value, and then deriving the actual capacity or the actual fuel state in a, I guess, a percentage-based format, if that's what we wanted to do. It's in gallons, right? So we know information about how this class would calculate the fuel state for us. With this class here, get percent fuel remaining. Okay, it's a good function name because it tells us exactly what it's going to return. But the implementation of it is completely abstracted away from us. We don't know if it's using gallons. We don't know what it's doing. We don't really have to care, because that's up to the author who wrote this interface to do that. All we care about is that when we use this class, we use this interface, we call this function, that we're receiving the current fuel state, or the fuel remaining in a percentage format. Okay, there is a difference between procedural and object-oriented programming languages. What we get with procedural programming is the whole purpose of that, of a procedural language, is to break down a program into a collection of variable structures and subroutines. And so C is a procedural language, and what we typically do in a C program is just that. In fact, this is a C program, and what we have here is a combination of structures, variables, and functions. Okay? The functions call other functions, and that's how this program works. We call main because that's the entry point. We start executing lines of code. these codes, these lines can call other functions, those functions can call other functions, but that's all that that program is doing. With object-oriented programming, then it's different, in that we're still trying to break down a program, but we're trying to break it down into objects that expose those behaviors through methods and data through members or attributes using the interfaces. So procedural programming, we use procedures to operate on data structures or on data. Object-oriented bundles the two together. So an object is something that we get, an instance of an object, an instance of a class, and it operates on its own data structure. Okay, so we try not to expose the implementation. We just simply expose methods that allows us to modify that data within the structure itself. But the object itself is the one that's doing the modification. It's only allowing us to interact with that data through the functions or the methods that it exposes. It doesn't expose the raw data directly on its own. So with that, then, we can talk about anti-symmetry. And that essentially here is saying that same thing. So what I wanted to do is look at, I've got to find the copy of the book I have. Okay, here it is. Here we go. Okay, so we'll look at some of these samples here in the book, and hopefully I can make some sense of it. Okay, so if we look at listing 6.5, procedural shape, and what this class has, let's see if I can get it on one screen here. Okay, we have square, rectangle, circle. Those have a couple of members, but they have no functions. When we look at class geometry then, class geometry provides functions that accept as arguments those classes. And so what we see here is that if we want to add a class, we could add public class triangle. If we added a class, then we'd have to change the functions. Every function in this geometry class would have to change. If we wanted to add a function, okay, so let's say that we just add a function to geometry. We'd add the function to geometry. Geometry would change, but none of the classes would. If we look at the same, a very similar example then, let's see here, right here, what we use objects, or an object-oriented, a polymorphic approach, then we have the opposite. What we have here then is that we don't have a geometry class, we have these different classes that implement shape. So each one has its member and then its function. If we wanted to add an additional shape, okay, so we have square, we have rectangle, and we have circle. Let's say that we wanted to add triangle. We could add a shape and it wouldn't affect any of the other classes. A new shape would not affect any other class. But if we wanted to add a function, we'd affect every single class, right? Because every single class then would have to inherit and implement its own version of that function. So I think these comments sum it up best. You know, procedural code makes it easy to add new functions without changing the existing data structures. Object-oriented code makes it easy to add new classes without changing existing functions. The complement is also true. Procedural code makes it hard to add new data structures because all the functions must change. Object-oriented code makes it hard to add new functions because all the classes must change. Okay, so we're just dealing with, in this case, we're just dealing with the differences in how we implement these different, different classes, the different styles, procedural versus the object-oriented. All right, and I was going to talk about the law of Demeter. I think that's how you pronounce it, but I think we'll save that for another time. So if you're interested in that, it's just a couple paragraphs in the book there. It's worth understanding or knowing, or at least reading about a little bit. That's really all I want to cover out of the chapter. So there's some topics left here to read. There's also a Wikipedia entry, so if you follow that, it gives a little more in-depth discussion of this law. With that, that's all I have. So again, relatively short. Take the rest of the time, please, to start on Lab 3 and to continue to work on the project. If you have any questions or any problems on anything, again, don't hesitate to contact me, send me an email, something, let me know, and I'll be more than happy to help as much as I can. So with that, have a good weekend, and don't forget, next Tuesday is no class, so there won't be a lecture, so we'll just have the one lecture next week on Thursday. So have a good weekend, and talk to you next week.